Okay, so the chapter name is Electrostatic Potential and Capacitance. Okay, so let's first write down the chapter's name. You will see that capacitance is, you know, slightly disjoint sort of topic. Okay, so we can study capacitor independently towards the end. Okay, and we treat electric potential, electrostatic potential, as if it is continuation of the previous topic itself. Okay, in fact, in most of the books, the way it is categorized is electrostatics 1 and electrostatic 2. In electrostatics 2, mainly they are talking about the capacitors, and electrostatic 1 is electric field, electric potential, dipoles and all that. Okay, but the way it is put forward in NCERT is that they have clubbed electrostatic potential and capacitance. Okay, now before we even start the electrostatic potential, let me just give you some analogy of whatever we have done in class 11. Okay. For example, in class 11, there was this topic, laws of motion, right? So what we did there, we dealt with forces, right? We dealt with, let's take example of gravitation. We have considered gravitation as gravitational force, right? And effect of that we have seen in laws of motion chapter. In fact, effect of that we have seen in kinematics chapter also. There was projectile motion. Accessing due to gravity will be down. Okay, so always till laws of motion chapter we have considered effect of gravitation as a force. Okay, then comes work by energy chapter. There the effect of gravitation we have taken as potential energy. Okay, we have treated whatever is the effect of gravitation, whatever happens because of that, okay, is potential energy. If there is a change in potential energy, velocity will come. Okay, now you can get that velocity by using it like a force also, because of gravity, acceleration will be there and velocity will come anyway. Okay, so you can get the same answer in two different ways. Alright, so when I am saying the effect of any conservative force like gravitation, okay, its effect you can, you know, study as two types. Okay, you can study the effect of that as a force, or effect of that as an energy. Okay, and when we are understanding effect of any conservative force as energy, then of course we are free to use work energy theorem. Okay, so all that we are going to study in this particular topic. Okay, and how many of you there when I was teaching gravitation? How many of you are not there? That would be the question. Okay, 4 or 5 of you were not there. Anyways, in gravitation, you remember we have defined potential energy because of gravitation. Yes or no? Okay. Stop talking, please. We have introduced Newton's universal law of gravitation, right? So in gravitation chapter itself, we have analyzed the gravitation chapter as a force, and then we have also taken it like a potential energy. Okay. Similarly, in electrostatics also, we have first understood the effect of the charges as electrostatic force. Okay, and that expression comes from Coulomb's law. Alright. And then we are going to study the effect of electrostatic force as a potential energy. That will be in this chapter. Okay. Now before we even get into that, first, do you know how we define the potential energy? What is the definition of potential energy? Do you know that? Potential energy by virtue of its position, shape, size, location, whatever it is. Okay. So in fact, all the mechanical energy other than kinetic energy is potential energy only. Okay. Kinetic energy, there is a straightforward expression. What is that? square. Okay, but when it comes to potential energy, potential energy can be of multiple different types. Okay, potential energy can be because of the gravitation, can be because of the spring, and can be because of the electrostatic force. Okay, so we should know how can we derive the expression for potential energy for a particular force. Do you remember how we define the expression for potential energy for any force? Do you remember? Potential energy due to any conservative force, how you used to define it? No one knows?
Sir, I didn't get the question properly.
Suppose I tell you that force is F and it is conservative. How you find out its potential energy?
Initial.
What do you mean by initial finding points? I want you to define the potential energy of a conservative force. What is the process of defining it? Potential energy is negative of the work done by the force. Okay? Fine. Potential energy is just a thing which we are defining for our convenience. Alright? So that you will be able to analyze the scenario a little bit more easily. Just to give you an example, for gravitation, let's say you have this mass m, okay? Suppose this is taken to a height of h, right? This is height h. Now, tell me how much work is done by the gravity over here. If I move this m from here to here, gravity is down, g. What is the work done by gravity?
Minus mgh.
Minus mgh? Minus of mgh was the work done by the gravity. Fine. So suppose I have to define gravitational potential energy. Then according to the definition of potential energy, change in potential energy should be negative of work done by the gravity. This will come out to be mgh. Okay. Now this kind of expression, this thing, can be used for any force, any conservative force. You can define potential energy. If you know the work done by that force, negative of that will be change in potential energy. Fine. For gravitation also we have defined similar way. Okay. Now let us try to derive the electrostatic potential energy. Fine. We'll use this only. Now for gravitation it was straightforward. Reason? Mg is a constant force. From here to here, mg was constant, so there was no problem. Force into displacement, right? Suppose force changes with height, you can't multiply force with displacement. Okay? For example, spring. Spring force changes as the spring compression or extension changes. Okay? So you can't just multiply force at any moment into displacement. Okay? So there you need to integrate. I'll tell you how. Let me take the example of. And you might be wondering why this topic is the electrostatic potential, but then we are talking about electrostatic potential energy. Okay? Just like previously, the topic was electric field, but first we have defined what is force. And then force per unit charge was field. Similarly here, first we will define potential energy, and then we will say that potential energy per unit charge is potential. Okay? Now suppose this is a scenario. You have let's say plus Q1 and this is plus Q2. This is distance R1. Okay, from this point the charge is slowly moved to that point. Now this distance becomes R2. Fine. From R1 distance, this Q2 has moved from R1 distance to R2 distance from a fixed charge Q1. Okay, both are point charges. Okay. Now my simple question is, what is the work done by the force between them? Okay, try to find out. Is the force of electrostatic between these two charges same throughout? Yes or no? When the charge goes from here to here, during this motion, is the electrostatic force constant?
No.
No. Right? So how do you do this question?
Integrate.
Why you integrate? Because the force is varying. Now the logic behind integral is like this. You know, you assume that charge is at a distance of R. Okay? So force is not between the two charges, the force will be KQ1 Q2 by R square. This is the force when the distance between them is R. Okay? Now suppose you move by a very very small distance dr. For this small distance, can I say force is constant? For this very small distance. Right? So I can say that work done, the small amount of work done to move from R to R plus dr is force into displacement. Now when I am multiplying force into this displacement, actually force is a vector quantity and displacement is also a vector quantity. It is a dot product between force and displacement. Okay? So is force in the direction of displacement or against the direction of displacement?
In the direction of displacement.
In the direction, so dot product is? Cos theta becomes 1. Okay? This is small work done. Okay? What if Q2 is of opposite sign of Q1? Then work done would be negative. Dot product should be negative. That will be automatically taken care by Q1 multiplied by Q2. Fine? So when you write potential energy, you write the sign of the charge also along with it. Okay? If both are of opposite sign, potential may come out to be negative. Or whatever it is, right? What my point is, when you are dealing with force, don't consider sign. Consider sign as an indication of direction and treat it separately. But when you're writing potential energy, consider the signs also. Okay? Because potential energy can be negative, potential energy can be positive. Alright, so this is small work done. Total work done will be integral of this. Right? Integral of this. Now which variable is varying? R is varying from where to where? R1 to R2. So the limits will be from R1 to R2. Right? So total work done dr by r square integral is what? Minus 1 by r. The limits will be from R1 to R2. This is the work done. Work done by whom? Work done by the force due to Q1 on Q2. Okay? So if I rearrange the terms, I get work done is equal to minus of K Q1 Q2 by R2. This This is what you will get. Okay. And negative of that is the change in potential energy according to the definition of potential energy. Fine. So negative of that is minus W should be equal to change in potential energy, which is U2 minus U1. U2 is potential energy over there and U1 is potential energy over here. Okay. So negative of work done will become K times Q1 Q2 by R2 minus of K times Q1 Q2 by R1. This is equal to U2 minus U1. Okay. Now can I say that U2 is equal to this and U1 is equal to that? Can I say it or not? How many say yes? Almost everyone?
Not sure.
Not sure, Krishna? Yes or no?
Yes.
So if you write 5 minus 3 is equal to 4 minus 2, 5 is equal to 4.
No, exactly.
Okay, so this doesn't mean that U2 is that and U1 is this. Okay, now if R2 tends to infinity, what will happen to this? Zero. That becomes zero. Right? So you will get minus of K Q1 Q2 by R1 is equal to potential energy infinity minus 1. Okay? So what is infinity? Distance between the charges is infinity. Okay? Does it mean that U infinity is equal to 0? Yes or no?
Yes. No. No.
Does it mean U infinity is equal to 0?
No.
How is it? I mean, I think some of you have doubts. See, thing is,
kind of.
If 0 plus 5 is equal to 10 minus 5, doesn't mean 10 equal to 0. Right? But whenever you write potential energy, you always have to assume something to be zero potential energy, yes or no?
Yes.
Like for example, when you write MGH, you assume the horizontal line to be zero potential energy, right? Similarly, if you remember, when I taught you gravitation, there also we have assumed when the infinite distance between the masses, potential energy to be zero, okay? Similarly here, if we assume U infinity to be 0. Okay? Now this assumption will not change your answer, because whenever you use potential energy, in every equation, just potential energy will never come. Change in potential energy will come. Okay? Change, if there is change that is coming in, well, you can take whatever as 0. Change in potential energy cannot get affected because of that. Are you getting it? For example, if you take a scale like this, okay, if you write 0 over here, this is 1, 2, 3, 4. This is 4 meter scale. But if you write 0 over here, this is what? 1, 2, this is minus 1, this is minus 2. So still the difference between this and this is 4. Okay? You can take whatever as 0. So that is why I have assumed U infinity to be 0. As absolute potential energy has no meaning, change in potential energy only will come. So this assumption is something which is agreed upon. It's not that almost every numerical you have to find out what is your zero potential energy. For example, when you write MGH as your potential energy, you have to assume some imaginary horizontal line to be zero potential energy. Okay? But here it is agreed. Write down that potential energy between the charges, potential energy between the charges will be zero if the distance between them is very large. Okay? If the distance between the charges is very large. Okay. So that is true, then potential energy will become equal to K times Q1, Q2 by R. This is the potential energy between the two charges. Okay? And mind you, this is not the potential energy of Q1 or potential energy of Q2. This is the potential energy of Q1, Q2 together. Okay? Just because Q1 and Q2 are located like that, because of that reason only they have this potential energy together as a system. This is the potential energy of the system. Fine. So at least you need two point charges for to have a potential energy. What are you doing? Are you comfortable? Some issue? Huh? कभी खड़ा हो रहा है, कभी बैठ रहा है, कभी नील डाउन जा रहा है, व्हाट इज द प्रॉब्लम? दिस इज द पोटेंशियल एनर्जी. ओके, एंड इफ q1 इनटू q2, इफ q1 इनटू q2 इज लेस देन 0, पोटेंशियल एनर्जी विल बी नेगेटिव. डोंट वरी अबाउट दैट, इट कैन बी नेगेटिव. फाइन. When it will be negative if Q and Q2 are of opposite signs. Fine? Okay? Write this down and let me know if you have any doubts. We have defined the potential energy between the two point charges. Okay? Between the two point charges only we have defined the potential energy till now. Clear? Pair of the charge. How many pair of charges you see here?
Three.
6. 6 pairs. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. Potential between this and that will be what? This. Okay. And how many such pairs are there? 4. Between this and this, the distance is root 2a. So plus kq square divided by root 2a multiplied by 2, 2 such pairs. So this is the total potential energy of the system, U. Okay, fine. Now you have to tell me how much work needs to be done to dismantle the system. Dismantling the system means that you are making them infinitely separable from each other.
Negative of this?
How it comes? Identity potential is zero. Like that you are put it. But then you also should remember that you can apply work energy theorem, you know, which is this. This is the work energy theorem. Feel free to apply this. Okay. I wanted you to find out work done W. K1 is 0, kinetic energy is 0, K2 also 0. We are assuming that we are just able to separate, you know, make them reach infinity. U2 is also 0. These two 0, K1 is 0, so W is negative of U1. Fine? Okay? Now tell me how much work is needed to be done to bring them from infinity to this. Use this.
How much?
From infinity to this location, if I have to bring these charges. Now U1 is?
Zero.
U1 is 0, K1 is 0, K2 is 0, and U2 is this. W will find out. Okay? So that work per energy chapter, whatever equation we have learned, all that holds good here as well. Okay? Now you have three types of potential energy which you know of. Gravitation, spring, electrostatic. All three can be present together also. Okay? So U2 is potential energy, sum of all the potential energies at the second location. U1 is sum of all the potential energy at the first location. K1 is kinetic energy at the first location. K2 is kinetic energy at the second location. Okay? Now, we can also extend the definition of potential energy for spherical charges. Okay? Like, for example, if you have a spherical shell of charge, uniformly distributed, even though it is not a point charge, outside itself it will behave like a point charge only. Okay? So, write down potential energy. Between two spherical charges. Okay, so what I mean to say is one sphere is like this and other sphere is like that. Okay, they are not very close to each other, because if they are close to each other, they will affect the charge distribution each other. Okay. This positive charge may reflect the positive charge over here, so it may not be uniformly distributed. So I am saying that they are at sufficient distance so that they don't affect the distribution of charge. Okay? Or they are insulated, charge can't move itself. Once you fix the charge at a location, it will remain there only. Fine? So if Q1 is distributed uniformly over here, Q2 is distributed uniformly, and distance between the centers is R. The potential between them is K times Q1, Q2 by R, as if they are point charges. Okay? Clear out? spheres you might be able to recollect similar question in gravitation. Okay? So there are two spheres, minus q distributed uniformly over here, minus 2q distributed uniformly over there. Radii are r and 4r. Okay? You need to find which what minimum velocity u we should project this plus q charge from the smaller sphere so that it reaches the bigger sphere.
The distance between two spheres.
Distance between two spheres. Important to know that this is 10 r. Minimum velocity u so that this charge reaches here. How should we go about this question? What should be the condition?
They should reach the point where the two forces are equal. The two forces
potential. If this charge reaches here, this sphere will pull it this way, and that sphere will pull it that way. As it is coming closer to this sphere, that force is becoming stronger and stronger, and this force becomes weaker and weaker. So you need to supply minimum velocity so that it reaches a point after which this force becomes stronger than that force. Once it reaches here, this sphere will automatically pull it towards itself. Fine? So you need to find where that force is balanced and then apply work energy theorem between point 1 and that point which you have found out. Okay? Try it. I will show the work point.
Is it like between the lambda and the force that point?
Yeah. Okay. Anyone? did you get the point where forces are equal?
Yes.
Suppose this is the point where the net force becomes zero. Let's say this is x. So this is F1 and that is F2. Okay, F1 is what? K q small q divided by x square. This is x. This is F1, right? F2 is what? K times 2q into small q divided by what? 10r minus x whole square. Okay, then k, q and this thing get cancelled away. You can take a square root, so 1 by x becomes plus minus root 2 divided by 10r minus x. Fine? Now 10r minus x is equal to plus minus root 2x. So x will be equal to 10r divided by 1 plus minus root 2. Now tell me, 1 plus root 2 or 1 minus root 2? You should. Why? X cannot be negative. Okay? And x should be less than 10r. 1 plus root 2. Okay? Now this is the weird value, so keep it like this. Assume x is known now. Okay?
Sir, if you say it's approximately 4r.
Correct. Whatever it is, I'm saying just assume x is known to you now. Alright? Now, between this point, between point 1 and between point 2, apply work energy theorem. What is the work energy theorem? W is equal to U2 plus K2 minus U1 plus K1. Now write down, just write down the equation. I don't care about the final answer right now. Written? Who all have written? Only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, tell me. K2 is what?
0.
0. K1?
No.
Half
m u square. M is not even, assume it to be m. Okay? Now, W is what?
Zero.
What is W?
KQ.
W is zero.
Zero.
You might be wondering that okay, the electrostatic force is doing work, but for that you have even considered potential energy. When you use gravitational potential energy, do you care about the work done due to gravity then?
No.
Either you treat it like a potential energy or like a force. If you are treating it like a force, then find out its work done. If you are treating it like a potential energy, don't then again find out the work done by that force. Because potential energy is defined like negative of the work done. So, if you take potential energy this side, it will become work done by the gravity or work done by the electrostatic force. Anyways, okay. Now, U1 is what?
Zero.
Charge is what? U1 is when charge is over here.
Yeah.
What is the potential energy? KQQ, what's the
QQ?
K small q, capital Q by?
By R.
By R. This is plus or minus?
Minus.
Then, what about potential between this and this?
Minus
2Q. Minus K into 2Q small q divided by from here to there distance, which is 9R. Is that it?
Yeah.
What about potential energy between this sphere and that sphere? Part of the system, right? How many charges are there total?
Three.
So how many potential energy will come? Three. Right? So plus potential energy between these two spheres. Now the good thing is that potential energy between these two is not changing before and after. So when you subtract, that U term will get disappeared. Getting it? Now U2 is what? Similarly you can write down U2. it will be minus KQQ divided by R plus, no, only X, X is from center, X, okay, then minus of K2Q Q divided by what, 10R minus X. N plus U. Any doubt? The values are not very nice, so don't worry about the final answer. Just care about the how we have written the expression. All of you understood?
Yes.
No doubt? No doubt, right? Let's take another similar question so that W is equal to 0. What is the only force available here? Electrostatic force. For that you have anyway considered the potential energy. Okay? So there is no other force for which you can find out the problem. Okay? If you take potential energy that side, negative of that element becomes work done. But then you have taken it on the right hand side anyways, potential energy. Okay? Let's take up another one. Finding this question difficult or
no?
When they are about to collide, that is the second point and this is your first point.
Yes.
Just write down the energy equation. Find out U1, U2, K1, K2. W is anyway 0.
Yeah.
And K1 is also 0. Just three things you have to find out. U2, K2 and U1. Only two charges are there, so only one potential energy will be involved.
So what will be the U2 when they are just touching?
When they are just touching. Center to center distance will be then? Will be R plus 2R, 3R. So many hits are there. I just made up a
question.
How
much is it? It's not. No, 600. Yes, I think it's actually.
What is K2? K2 is not zero. When they are about to collide, they will have some velocities, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Let's say U1 and U2 are the velocity. I am asking what is U1 and what is U2? Q1, that is why there is a potential energy when you place Q1, Q2 over here. right? So it makes sense to define a physical variable which is potential energy per unit charge. Are you getting it? More is the value of Q2, more is the potential energy.
Yes
or no? Right? And it is directly proportional to Q2. So if I take 1 coulomb of charge, if potential energy is X, then if I take 2 coulomb of charge, potential energy will be 2X. Right? So it makes sense to define what is the potential energy per unit charge, whatever I keep here. So that if I multiply that with a charge, I'll get the potential energy directly. Okay? Now when it is a point charge, it is very simple. Direct formula of potential energy is there. But what if it is not a point charge, it is like a line of charge. The charge is distributed from here to here. Then there is no direct formula. So what I have to do? Then I have to find out what is the potential energy per charge for this entire rod over here and then multiply Q2 with it. Getting my point? Yes. So that is why there should be another variable defined which keeps track of what is the potential energy per unit charge. So just like electric field, which is force per unit charge, we are defining a physical quantity that is potential energy per unit charge, and that we call potential. Fine? So simply, potential is first of all represented by letter capital V, which is potential energy divided by charge. Okay? Now if someone asks you the definition of potential, then this is the definition of potential. Write down, potential is the work done. Potential is the work done per unit charge, or potential energy is the work done. Potential energy is the work done to move one unit of charge, to move one unit of charge from infinity to the point where you're finding the potential. Potential is work done